Good morning and happy Trinity Sunday to you all. I pray you're all having a blessed morning and enjoying the, here in our area, at least enjoying the lack of rain that has finally come to us, that we can actually move around a little bit this morning following worship. We give thanks to God for that. A few announcements that we'd like to share this morning as we prepare for worship. Our food pantry is open every Saturday at 8 a.m., 8 to 9 in the morning. If you have need of food, you're welcome to come at that time or arrange another time with our staff if you have any need of food or basic items that we might be able to provide. We're also continuing to partner with the Showering Love Ministry. That's every Tuesday. They are offering hot showers to the needy in the community, plus hygienic goods. Last week there were doctors and medical professionals doing all kinds of tests, health checks, and that's really a wonderful blessing. That's every Tuesday morning. As to our Tuesday afternoon Bible study and Thursday afternoon Bible study, as well as our Tuesday afternoon coffee talk, we're going to take a break from all that this week. And everything will resume the next week. So this coming week on Tuesday, there will be no Bible study, no coffee talk. And on Thursday, there will be no Spanish Bible study. Just this week. We are excited to announce that we've started to make some plans and shore up some plans for reopening the physical buildings of the church. Our sanctuary, beginning to have worship once again in our sanctuary. And as we say, God willing, that would be starting on the 28th of June. You know, God willing that unforeseen events don't interrupt those plans. But we're beginning to make plans for opening on June 28th. Of course, we'll have to have all the social distancing and all those kind of things, masks and all that sort of fun stuff. So it won't be like church used to be for a while, but it would be wonderful to be back in the building. So that's starting on June 28th of this month. There are items from Publix, and Robert Johnston will be at the church offering those goods between 11:30 and 12. So if you are able to be part of that, you are, if you're able to join and be part of that, you're very welcome to be present with that at that time and benefit from those goods. And just a reminder, our staff is present at the church for anything you may need. Some of you are saying there's no sound. And are you able to hear me? If you're able to hear me, say yes. Can anyone hear me? If you're able to hear me, say yes. Okay, the sound is low, but there. All right, so I'll try to speak up and hopefully you'll be able to hear me. Just a reminder that our staff is present at the church for whatever we can offer to you. So please feel free to give us a call, contact the church office, and let us know if there's any way we can serve you as a staff. And a reminder to give to our church through the webpage. You can give through the webpage, sunsetpc.org. Push the donate button. You can give electronically. Send in your checks through the mail, or bring them to the church and give them to the staff. And we'll be happy to receive them and happy to see you at the same time. Let us now prepare ourselves for worship with an opening prayer. And we will offer that prayer. And I just invite you to bow your heads and be in an attitude of prayer as we begin this morning. God in three persons, blessed Trinity, we ask for your presence to enter into this space and into our lives. We know that in self-giving love, your very nature teaches us how to love one another. Father and Creator, Son and Redeemer, Spirit and Advocate, we call upon you to teach us in this hour. Teach us to pray. Teach us to love. Teach us to be one as you are one. With all our divisions we create with our own biases, from social class to race, from gender to age, from ability to disability and different abilities, we know we still have much to learn. Teach us this hour, we pray, in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. We'd like to continue praying with a prayer of confession. So I invite you to be in an attitude of confession. I will offer a prayer and I will give an opportunity in silence for you to bring whatever you'd like to bring before the Lord before we receive the assurance of God's forgiveness. So let us pray. Triune God, you gather, protect, and care for us, your beloved, through word and spirit. This you have done from the beginning of the world and will do until the end. Have mercy upon us and forgive us for sinning against you. We have not loved one another as we should. We have not sown the seeds of gospel hope. We have not always been present for worship with you. Restore us, O Lord. May we give ourselves willingly and joyfully to be a benefit and blessing to one another, that we may truly share one faith, have one calling, be of one soul and one mind for the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And hear now the prayers and confessions that we offer before you in silence. Amen. Who is in a position to condemn us? Only our Lord Jesus Christ. And Christ died for us, Christ rose for us, Christ reigns in power for us, and Christ prays for us. Friends, brothers, and sisters, believe the good news. In the name of Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Amen. Amen. I'd like to share another hymn with you at this time, a hymn which is All Creatures of Our God and King. It's a beautiful arrangement, and I just invite you to sing along with the words on the screen. I hope you can hear the music at this time. Praise the Father, praise the Son, praise the Spirit, three in one. It's a reminder of Trinity Sunday, and that is the Sunday that we're celebrating today. Let us now turn to our scripture lesson from Matthew's Gospel, Matthew chapter 28, verses 16 through 20. You're welcome to read along in your own Bibles at home, in whatever version of the Bible you may have. Matthew 28, verses 16 through 20, and it's called the Great Commission. And it's important to us for Trinitarian reasons, as we'll be talking about this morning. Matthew 28, verses 16 through 20. Please listen for the word of God. Then the 11 disciples went to Galilee, to the mountain where Jesus had told them to go. When they saw him, they worshiped him, but some doubted. Then Jesus came to them and said, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely I am with you always, to the very end of the age." This is the word of the Lord. We give thanks to God. Well, in their famous 1953 comedy sketch, Bud Abbott and Lou Costello caused pandemonium with one another when Abbott tries to explain the players and positions on a baseball team. You may remember this famous speech or seen it on the internet. Bud Abbott says, "Now, who's on first? What's on second? And I don't know is on third." And Costello is visibly confused and he says, "I don't know who's on first, you tell me." Costello replies, "No, I don't know is on third base." And the gag goes on and on. The 8-minute sketch became one of the best known comedy sketches of all time, probably because it illustrates how easy it is to become confused when people misunderstand each other's terminology in a conversation. Well, a similar level of confusion can arise, although with less comic results, when we talk about the doctrine of the Trinity. Both before and after the doctrinal battles over the Trinity in the 4th and 5th centuries, the Trinity has never been an easy subject, and it's never resulted in a complete consensus among Christians over how we are to understand God in three persons. Beginning in the New Testament, Christians bore witness to their convictions that God presents God's self in three primary ways to us human beings: as God the Father and creator of all, God the Son in the person of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, and God the life-giving and guiding Spirit. Although it's true that the absolute formations of doctrine around the Trinity developed in the 4th and 5th centuries, they definitely grew out of biblical roots, as we will be seeing this morning. There are a number of texts in Matthew's Gospel, just to take one example, that show us inklings of the understanding of the Trinity among earliest Christians. At the scene of Jesus' baptism in chapter 3, there is the Spirit of God descending like a dove over Jesus, the Son, while he's getting baptized, and a voice at the same time coming from heaven saying, "This is my beloved Son, with whom I am well pleased." The Spirit, the Son, and the Father. The three persons of God appear again in the account of Jesus' temptation in the wilderness as Jesus, the Son of God, is led by the Spirit, the Holy Spirit, into the wilderness and is able to overcome temptation by worshiping the Lord his God. And finally, at the end of the gospel we read this morning, in what we often call the Great Commission in Matthew 28, Jesus tells his disciples to go into all the world and baptize in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. The three persons of God appear again and again. But we shouldn't miss something very important in this short text that we read this morning, that Matthew links the Great Commission. We often focus on this Great Commission: go into all the world, make disciples of all nations, baptize, teach, everything that Jesus has taught. That often gets separated. But we shouldn't miss the fact that Matthew connects that with the Trinity, with the Trinitarian formula. Matthew wanted his people to know it's not only good enough to go out and do all these things, you have to do those things for the right reasons. It's not only important what we do, it's important in whose name and for whose glory we do it. And when it comes to faith, we should do the right things for the right reasons, for the glory of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. Well, a teenage girl in India gave us an amazing example of doing the right things for the right reasons just this past month. 15-year-old Jyoti, which is her name, was caring for her father, Mohan, who had been a driver in the city of New Delhi in India until he was injured in a traffic accident and he could no longer work. And so Jyoti came and was trying to take care of him and take him to medical visits and get him his medicines. And all that was going okay until the coronavirus lockdown hit and the entire nation of India was paralyzed and all the public transport was shut down. Mohan could no longer drive or move around the city because of his injuries, and Jyoti was unable to take him for medical visits, and there was nothing that she could do to bring money or food or medicine for the two of them. When they were down to just $20, Jyoti spoke to her father, Mohan, and said, "Why don't we take this money and buy a bicycle and ride this bicycle back to our village?" Well, the only problem was their village is 700 miles from the city of New Delhi. And Mohan didn't think this was a spectacular plan, and he tried to talk his daughter out of it, but they got to the point where it looked like they might starve to death otherwise. And so he agreed. They took the $20 and went and bought a secondhand bicycle. And with Mohan sitting on the seat and Jyoti standing and pedaling the bicycle, they pedaled 700 miles. They traveled 700 miles in 7 days. This amazing and superhuman feat brought Jyoti international attention and recognition and fame. And they're trying to recruit her now for the Olympic bicycle team for the upcoming Olympics. But what's very important to recognize here is that she didn't ride across India on a bicycle with her father in tow behind her just so that she could become famous or achieve international renown. She did this to save her father's life and her own. She did the right thing for the right reasons. Such an impact and a testimony of love, the love of this girl, Jyoti, to her father, Mohan. And that loving relationship between the two of them gives us a great example, because the Trinity, when we get to the Trinity, it's not about formulas, it's not about three in one and one in threes, it's about relationship. The Trinity teaches us so much about relationship. Firstly, the Trinity teaches us about God's relationship with us. In fact, the only way we can know anything about a Trinity, the only way we could think of a concept such as the Trinity, is because of God's self-revelation to us. The fact that God has shown himself to us as Heavenly Father, as Savior and Son, and as empowering spirit. God's relationship to us teaches us about the Trinity. The Trinity teaches us about relationship within God's self as well. The Bible shows us how the Father sends the Son and the Spirit. The Son bears witness to the Father and the Spirit, and the Spirit opens our eyes to know the Father and the Son. Some have compared the Trinity to a divine dance of love within God's self. And I think that's an amazing image. The Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit dancing with one another in love. That relationship within God's self is revealed to us in the Trinity. And finally, the Trinity pushes us to relate to all kinds of other people. We read this text from that's called the Great Commission this morning. Go into all the world, make disciples of all nations, baptize, teach in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. The only way to carry out that Great Commission, the only way to make disciples from all nations, the only way to baptize in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, the only way to teach all the things that Christ has taught us is through relationship with others. You can't do it by remote control. You can't do it at a distance. You can't do it by leaving tracts on bus stop benches. It has to be done through relationships. But relating to all kinds of people, as we know, is no easy thing to do. Because there are people we'd rather not relate to, aren't there? We've all seen the riots and demonstrations going on in cities all over America, in our own city as well. And in these riots, as we watch, and in these demonstrations, as we watch one side and another side, we probably identify with one side or another. Maybe we identify more with the demands of the protesters for justice. Or maybe we identify more with those who are trying to keep order and peace in the midst of the chaos. And maybe there are people that we would prefer would just go away and disappear. But if we look closely and carefully in the midst of the chaos, we can see some amazing things happening. We can see some police marching with protesters, and some protesters protecting and defending the police. We can see some protesters preventing others from damaging people's property. To live in a society is to live in relationship, even when we're at odds with one another, even when we're disagreeing and arguing with one another. The Trinity means that we can't just write other people off, as much as we might like to do that. We remember that in Scripture we see some of the most hopeless cases, some of the most hopeless people, people like David and Peter and Paul and Mary Magdalene. They're people that God uses to further his kingdom, to share his message, to preach the word of God. It's impossible to just write people off, as much as we'd like to do that sometimes. The times we are living in are rough. There's no doubt about that. To all the complexities of the COVID-19 situation and pandemic, we now have to add mass demonstrations and sometimes mass riots that we have to deal with. But we have to remember that what we're going through these days is not new. Biblical scholars believe that Matthew's gospel was written down around the year 80 AD, right after a terrible war was fought with Rome, between Rome and Judea. And the Judean countryside was devastated. Jerusalem was overrun by Roman forces. The temple was destroyed. And the new Christian communities became refugees. Matthew's community became refugees in Antioch, in Syria. They knew difficult times. They went through hard times. And even so, they could take comfort in the God who had revealed himself as Father and Son and Holy Spirit. The Trinity is about God with us in amazing and varied and exciting ways. Let us go out and live our lives in the midst of all that we're going through and be witnesses in that confidence. Remembering that as God, as Father and Son and Holy Spirit, has promised to be with us always, every day, no matter what we're going through, until the end of the age. Amen. Amen. We come into a time of prayer once again, and this is an opportunity for you to bring prayer requests and needs before the gathered community. And so I invite you at this time, if there are any prayers you would like to offer, any concerns or thanksgivings, or anything we'd like to pray for. I would like to give thanks with regard to the demonstrations and some of the violence that we've seen in some places around the United States, that our own community hasn't been terribly impacted by those conflicts. We've seen demonstrations, most of them have been peaceful, and we just pray for continued, we pray for people to have the opportunity to express themselves openly and to seek justice where they feel that they need justice while doing it peacefully. So we just pray that there would be no more damage to property, and we pray no loss of life in those demonstrations that are going on. Are there other prayers that we'd like to lift up at this time? Continued prayers for the situation of the virus, for the medical professionals, the doctors and the nurses, first responders. Those are all people we want to continue praying for in the midst of this pandemic that continues to go on. We pray for churches that are reopening already, and just ask that God would keep them safe and watch over them, as well as the businesses, that those businesses would succeed and do well, even despite the setbacks that they have suffered through this pandemic. Are there other prayers that we'd like to lift up? Trying to give a moment if there are any prayer requests that we'd like to lift up before the community. Yes, prayers of thanks for those who are feeding the homeless and the hungry that are working very hard. Prayers for Dan MacArthur, who is in hospital with pneumonia. Thanksgiving for a good office visit for Wayne this week. We give thanks and pray God's presence with those who are in need. So let us pray. Gracious Heavenly Father, loving Son and Savior, and life-giving Spirit, we come before you on this Trinity Sunday giving thanks for all the amazing and beautiful ways that you are present in our lives and in our midst. Lord, we confess that we don't always understand what it means to be the Trinity, and we don't always understand what it means to love one another, especially when loving one another gets really hard. We pray your presence and your guidance, that you would show us the ways to love one another. We pray your presence for those who are going through illnesses and sicknesses at this time, those who are hospitalized, those who are going back and forth for medical treatments during this difficult and challenging time. We just pray that you would be present with each and every person in each and every situation. Lord, that you would provide for those who are lacking employment or who are not able to get enough work hours to cover their expenses. We ask that you would provide for them, that you would give them what they need, give them their daily bread. We pray for a return to business for many companies that have been closed for a long time. We pray for churches, Lord, that are beginning to return to worship, and others like us that are planning to return, and others that are still just thinking it's safer to wait this thing out. Lord, we ask that you would be present with each and every one of them, that you would guide and give wisdom and give safety and protection, Lord, to those who are gathering together once again. We pray your presence in the midst of this virus, in the midst of this uncertainty, and in the midst of the the demonstrations that we see around us. We pray for an end to the loss of property and lives in the midst of the demonstrations and the conflicts that are going on. But yet we also raise up that call for justice and pray that justice would always be done to all people, regardless of color and background. We pray for this church. We pray for Sunset Presbyterian Church and the ways that we are a kind of microcosm of your community. We are people from all backgrounds, and we're thankful that we can gather together and worship as one, whether it's online or in person. Lord, continue to join us together and bind us together more closely, regardless of our language, regardless of our cultural backgrounds, that we might be one as you are one in Father and Son and Holy Spirit. We pray all these things in Jesus' name. And we pray also in the words that our Lord Jesus Christ taught us to pray in the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Amen. We thank you for being with us this morning, and we just remind you of the announcements that our food pantry program is going on every Saturday for those who are in need of food and basic items. Please come by. You're welcome to come by on Saturday mornings or arrange another time with us to come by the church and receive those items. Showering Love Ministry continues every Tuesday, and we're thankful to be partnering with them in the ways that they're serving the community. Our Bible study and coffee fellowship and our Tuesday Bible studies and Thursday Bible studies and coffee fellowship are all on break this week, so none of those are taking place this week, but we'll be returning once again in the next week to our regular schedule. We're making plans to reopen the physical building of Sunset Presbyterian Church on the 28th of this month, so we invite you to be in prayer for us as we prepare those plans for reopening the church buildings. And Rob Johnson is at the church today, starting at 11:30. For those who would like to come and get some of the items from Publix Bakery, you're welcome to do that. And a reminder to continue to give to the church through sunsetpc.org or by check in the mail, or just bring it by the church. And now receive the benediction. Let us go forth into the world, being children of our Heavenly Father, following our Savior, the Son of God, our Lord Jesus Christ, and following the direction and the energizing power of the Holy Spirit. And may the grace, mercy, and peace of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit live and abide with every one of us today and every day. Amen. Amen. Thank you for being with us this morning, and we pray you have a wonderful day. Until we meet again, God bless you.